listening to the best radio station on Long Island.
As voted by Long Islanders like you in the Bethpage Best of Long Island Awards.
The voice of Nassau Community College.
This is the award-winning 90.3 WHPC HD Garden City.
Listen on your smart speaker.
Play WHPC.
And available on Odyssey, TuneIn, iHeart, and on the WHPC app.
90.3 WHPC.
WHPC, the voice of Nassau Community College. Welcome to another edition of From the Press Box here every Monday, 9 a.m. to 10 a.m. My name is Rob Leonard. Joining me, of course, is my brother and award-winning sports writer, Tim Leonard.
Good morning,
Hello, brother. How are you?
I'm outstanding, brother. How about you?
I'm doing fine.
How's my mic levels? Are they good?
Yeah, they look fine. They look great. Anyway, today is July 3rd, 2023, and lots of sports happened in the past week. The one that was a little, how do you describe it, less than, boy, they were really loud out there. Can you hear them?
Yeah, I can.
Yeah, I can hear them too. Anyway, I don't know if the people listening can hear it, but anyway, I think the big story this past week had to be Steve Cohen having a press conference, then not really doing much with it.
Well, Domingo Germán did throw a perfect game, brother.
Yeah, that doesn't matter.
It's a big story.
That's a big story, but it's not the Mets. Anyway, if you'd like to have a question or comment, we'd love to hear from you. 516-572-7440. I'm going to start off with Uncle Stevie, brother, because he has a press conference, and people are maybe expecting someone to get fired or someone to be yelled at, and neither one happened.
I liked the press conference. I'll be honest, I liked it.
Yeah, well, it's a different type of thing. You know, we've seen owners in New York who've screamed and yelled, and sometimes that works. Most of the time, it really doesn't.
And that's why I liked it.
Yeah, so. But at the same time, something's got to happen to the Mets, because the Mets have been playing horrible. You don't pay all this money and expect your team to be a piece of crap. So, you know, that's maybe one of my problems with what's going on.
Well, the problem with the Mets, brother, is there's a couple things. Number one, the bullpen is trash.
I agree.
And I mean, you know, I was watching the game last night, and it felt like the Giants were going to come back and win. And the Giants' bullpen is probably worse than the Mets. But it took until Pete Alonso finally hit a home run that you could say, all right, maybe they're safe. Because the Mets have a lot of bad relievers. And why this wasn't addressed when Steve Cohen was spending $360 million in the offseason, I'm not 100% sure. And I know that, you know, they signed David Robertson late, and they signed Adam Ottavino, and they figure, all right, there's a seventh and eighth innings taken care of. But neither one of those guys is to me an overly reliable pitcher anymore. Now, Robertson's had a very good season. I got no problems with Robertson, even though he gave up a big home run the other night. But Ottavino has been he's not reliable. He hasn't been reliable since before he left the Yankees.
Right.
He's that guy who, when you know he gets wild every once in a while, he'll give up home runs. He's not a shutdown kind of reliever. You know, like I as a Yankee fan, I look at guys like Chad Green when Chad Green was going real good, and Michael King a couple years ago. Guys like that who every time they came into the game, you knew you were getting a zero in the inning. And when they gave up a run, it was a shock. So the Mets don't have anybody like that. And yes, I know the Edwin Diaz injury was unfortunate, and it put the Mets in a situation that they didn't expect to be in. But even with Edwin Diaz around, this bullpen would not be good. You'd have a great closer, but you wouldn't have a great bullpen.
That might help, brother. I mean, I keep forgetting that Diaz isn't there this year because of the way he went. You know, it happened while he was playing for another team, basically.
Yeah, the World Baseball Classic.
Right, so. And I think that's part of it. So, you know, I always keep forgetting about him. So,
well, that fans don't forget about him, but
yeah,
you know, but that's a big problem for the Mets. And the Mets' other problem is their lineup, for the most part, is filled. Yes, it's filled with veterans, but it's filled with a lot of veterans who have gotten old very quickly. Starling Marte has gotten old. Canna has gotten old. You know, all these free agents they signed. Eduardo Escobar, who was the third of the free agents that they signed a couple years ago, he's not even on the team anymore.
Right, right.
So you have a lot of guys who are batting in the low 200s, and I don't know of anybody in baseball who didn't think that everybody's average was going to go up this season because the shift was done away with. But for a lot of Mets hitters, that's not the case. I mean, Francisco Lindor is still not hitting well. He has started to hit better since the birth of his daughter a couple weeks ago. So I don't know, maybe lack of sleep agrees with Francisco Lindor, because I don't know how you sleep with a new baby in the house. But for whatever reason, it has sparked his bat. Pete Alonso not hitting well for average, but the power numbers are there, and that's all you ever want from Alonso.
Yeah,
but Alonso's never going to be a 270, 280 hitter. That's not
who
he is.
You know what's reminding me of, brother?
What?
Dave Kingman.
He's not that bad a hitter.
No, but he's batting 221.
Well, I mean, that's low for him.
Horrible.
Pete Alonso, I would like 250 from him. I mean, I don't think that's too much to ask. For a guy who hits that many home runs.
I want him 270.
He's not a 270 hitter. His numbers and you'll see. So, you know, you look at those guys and you see what their career numbers are, and a lot of Mets players are underperforming this year. And you know, the whole situation with Vogelbach early on in the season, and Mets fans wanted him, you know, either taken out of the lineup or killed, one or the other. You know, he is a little bit better recently, but the Mets, they've been shut out, what, 9-10 times this season? That's a lot. That's a lot.
Yes, they have. Hold
so
on.
That's
I'm
crazy.
Just looking at Dave Kingman.
Don't look at Kingman. Look at Alonso.
Shut up for a second.
Jesus.
Okay, when he was with the
that's
Mets.
Good radio, brother. Tell me
yeah,
to shut up.
It is.
Great
it
radio.
Is. That's great radio. He was batting 231, 238,
nobody
223.
Cares. Nobody cares about Dave Kingman.
I'm just saying.
You're obsessed with him.
I'm just saying his numbers
tell
are.
Tell me what Alonso is.
He's batting 221.
And what has he done in the past?
What has he done in the past? Okay,
yes. Give me the last three seasons of Alonso's
okay,
batting
hold
average.
Let me see where it's. They don't include
you
the.
You go on these ridiculous tangents.
That's what I do, brother. You know, you have to realize that. If you don't want to, then you can go somewhere else. Okay, 256 career.
Yeah, there you go. Thank you. What'd I just say?
Well, he had 231 in. Well, he was injured in 2020. Well, that was a.
He's hurt right now. I got news for you. He got hit in the hand, and he was out for, 10 days, and then he came back way earlier than anybody thought he would. Well. And since then, he's been batting about 160. So credit to the guy for playing hurt and doing what he can to help the team, but maybe he should realize that, hey, I should let my hand heal.
I agree.
Instead, he's going to the All-Star game to hit in the home run derby and playing the game because he got voted in as the only Met. You got a $280 million shortstop who didn't make the All-Star team?
I voted for him. Oof. Anyway, we have Joe up from Albany. Joe, welcome back to the show. How you doing?
Good morning, Rob. Good morning, Tim. How you guys doing?
Good, Joe. How are you?
Doing okay. What do you want to talk about?
Well, I got a window of opportunity here. I'm trying to mow the lawn and listen to you guys live rather than on the replay. How's
okay.
That?
Thank you. Thank you.
And for what that's worth.
Hope your lawnmower's quiet.
Yeah, well, it's one of those battery ones, so it's pretty quiet.
There you go.
Okay.
But I just wanted to just chime in on the Uncle Stevie thing. I thought it was a great press conference. I love the way he's going with it. You know, it's almost midway point. Both the Yankees and the Mets aren't doing well, but, you know, it's a long season, and we hear the blah, blah, blah. It's a grind and all that stuff. Just a breath of fresh air. I also think like Cal, you know, and Tim knows, I refer to it as the Fire and Trade Brigade, you know, back up the East River barge for the Yankees and get rid of everybody. But, you know, the question, and Tim always asks them, who are you going to replace them with?
Right, exactly.
Who are you getting? You know, all that stuff. But I have to say, though, Tim, yesterday, my wife and I were watching yesterday the Yankee game, and I think our Tri-City Valley Cats right now, managed by Pete Incaviglia, could give them a run for their money.
I was looking this weekend at the batting orders the Yankees were running out against the St. Louis Cardinals, and it's embarrassing. There's no other way to put it. It's embarrassing. It's not a major league ball club. Because you look at DJ LeMahieu, who right now should be in the Mets lineup because he's batting about 227 or something absurd like that. And his batting average should be at minimum 80 points higher. The hitter. He's a 300 hitter. That's what the Yankees signed a couple years ago when they gave him that 6-year extension. They signed a 300 hitter, not a 227 hitter.
He doesn't look good. And, you know, a couple of weeks ago or a week or so ago, Buck was kind of loose cannoning a little bit in one of the pressers about he wouldn't have batted that guy there or whatever that was. That's one of the reasons I called, Tim. These lineups, I mean, I think my cat could make up a better batting order than some of these batting orders we're seeing. Is that
for the Yankees or the Mets?
The Yankees. Is that an effect of the analytics more?
Yeah,
or
yeah. The one thing that the normal fan doesn't really either hear or understand is that all of the decisions that are being made nowadays are being made before the game.
Correct.
So it's a group of people who are making the lineup. It's not Aaron Boone. It's not, you know, Aaron Boone's not you know, saying, oh, I got a gut feeling today. I'm going to throw whoever in the lineup. You know, just like pick a name. It's not like the old days with Billy Martin, where Billy Martin would say, oh, you know, I got a feeling about this. I'm going to throw him in. Now it's all analytics and who has a you know, career numbers against a certain pitcher. You know, that's what rules everything, and that's what dictates everything.
That's killing it. I think I don't like that at all. I don't know how Rob feels about it, because I think they're doing similarly on the Mets too, aren't they?
Yeah, every team does that nowadays.
There's too much. You know, analytics is like last week we were driving, coming up on 95, coming home from our cousins, and we were on the Waze thing, and the Waze says, well, there's no traffic up on the GW Bridge. Meanwhile, we're at the Gothels Bridge. So we drive up to the GW Bridge, but we wasted 45 minutes getting there instead of just crossing, whether it's the Lincoln Tunnel or whatever. And, you know,
Joe, can you tell which way my brother wanted to go?
Well, you might want to call
which way we actually went.
Maybe enact the spirit of Phil Rizzuto for that or something with the GWB.
He's going the other way on a GW.
No, I know, but still, he'd be going 5 hours early, right?
That's what I look, the way I look at analytics. It's, you know, one thing in your hand says, oh, it's going to be this way because we have all this information. That doesn't mean you can't get across the Gothels Bridge and the Staten Island Expressway.
Right.
So
right.
The real point, though, is that, and my brother is making gestures. Anyway, the real point here is that you can see how frustrated Buck is in some of these post-game press conferences. Can you not?
Oh, yeah.
It's because early in his managing career, Buck was making decisions.
Right.
And a lot of those decisions have been taken out of his hands. Especially, you know, when you look at Vogelbach, do you think that Buck Showalter wants to play Vogelbach every day? No, he doesn't, because he knows better. Buck is a baseball guy. He's an old-school baseball guy. And does he use analytics? Absolutely he does. He was probably one of the first guys to start thinking about analytics. And he had analytics in his head before these guys started using computers. That's how solid he has been all of his career about who's better in what situations and using that information. But I can guarantee you that 70-something-year-old Buck Showalter can't stand it that he's got some 30-something-year-old guy with a computer telling him who to bat seventh or eighth when he's like, look, just let me make a lineup. I don't need you guys for this.
Yeah, I think it's terrible. Now one more thing, since I mentioned him, the Tri-City Valley Cats, our unaffiliated Frontier League team that we have. We have a six-game package, too, that we go to with some friends. And it's a lot of fun. There's a couple of ex-major leaguers in there. Of course, Pete Incaviglia is the manager, which is always – he had a rough time the other night with the Yumps, just to share it with you.
So did Aaron Boone last night.
Yeah, he got tossed. But I thought Pete was going to get tossed because here's one of the things. We're on the third baseline between third and home plate. Left-handed batter hits a ball down the line to the left of the foul pole, and the right field umpire calls it a foul ball.
The right field umpire?
Yeah.
Those leagues, how many umpires do they have? I know a lot of those leagues will have three.
There's a guy on the line, there's a guy by third, and they obviously shift when there's runners on base and stuff like that. But one more thing about those guys. There's a lot of fun guys to watch. There's this guy, you can look him up, Carson McCusker. He's like 6'7", 6'8". He's an outfielder, kind of like Judge Esch almost.
Okay. I don't know the name, so how old is he?
I think he's in his late 20s, but...
Name's not familiar.
According to Incaviglia, he said it's a crime. He was quoted in the paper one day. He said it's a crime some MLB team hasn't taken a flyer on this kid. And we've seen some big hits by this guy. He looks like a pretty decent player. But
I mean, the issue is, though, if he's in his late 20s, then a team isn't going to bring somebody that age into their system, especially if he's going to need a couple years of development. Because then by the time they get him to the majors, he's going to be at least 30.
Yeah, I think they got him out of college. They get guys different ways. Some of the rules are, you know, they got to have major league service. They got to do this. They got to do that. It's a weird kind of thing. But anyway, I just wanted to get your take on the analytics and the Buck thing and the Boone thing. I think Boone, I mean, it's so frustrating. I'm not a fire and trade guy, as you know, but
same here.
He just, besides the analytics, he doesn't seem to have his head in the game with the situations. And that's really frustrating to watch. At least it appears that way.
You talking about Boone or Buck?
I'm talking about Boone right now at the moment. Buck's always got his head in the game. Buck, you don't need to worry about that.
That's the one thing you never have to worry about. Buck is being focused. I mean, Boone, it's hard. For me, it's hard to say, to agree with that, only because what does Boone have on the bench? I mean, the Yankees bench is incredibly weak. It's just... And with Judge, we still have no clue how long he's going to be out for. I mean, some of the other injured guys are coming back, but this was what Yankee fans were worried about in the offseason. Yes, they re-signed Rizzo, great. They re-signed Judge, great. But what did they add? They didn't add anything. Giancarlo Stanton is a passenger at this point. He's barely hitting 200. He's not getting any big hits. And Giancarlo Stanton was supposed to be the guy who, when Judge got hurt or had a missed time, then Stanton was supposed to be the guy to carry the team. He can't carry a Girl Scout troop at this point.
It's a statement when you got guys like McKinney and Bowers making more of an impact, sort of, than those name guys you were saying.
Right. But, I mean, those – when you look at the Yankees outfield, it's – like you said, it's McKinney, Kiner Falefa, and I don't even remember who's in right field, but they're I mean, you know, nothing against these guys. I know they're trying hard and they've been producing some, but they're nobodies. These are not playoff players.
I feel a little sorry for IKF because, boy, as I call him, the quote unquote fans are all over him. And the guy does anything they ask him to do.
I have no idea why the fans would be on him. I mean, first of all, the only issue I have with IKF is he got $6 million in the offseason, which I thought was ridiculous. But the same time, he has won a Gold Glove in the past. He's doing a very good job, I think, just because he'll play anywhere. Like you said, he said in spring training, he basically said, look, I want to stay here. I will play anywhere you want me to. And he's done a good job.
Yeah, and where did he get the Gold Glove, Tim? Third base.
Third base, exactly.
Yeah.
So, and Donaldson is, you know, he's hitting an occasional home run, but that's about it.
That's tough to watch.
Volpe is basically one of the few guys who's hitting right now, and that was after the chicken parm dinner that he had with Austin Wells, who's a minor league catcher for the Yankees. That's been a couple of at least 2 weeks now that Volpe's his batting average over the last couple of weeks is like .350.
You're saying that chicken parm is important, brother?
Yes, bro. I knew you would love that.
I love chicken.
That
bread.
That was important in that case, Rob. You're right. Hey, listen, guys. I enjoy the show. I always listen to the replay if I don't catch it live.
Much appreciated, Joe.
I got to get back to mow my lawn before it rains again.
Okay.
All right, Joe. Thanks for the call.
Thanks,
appreciate
take
it.
Take care. Bye bye. 516-572-7440. 516-572-7440. If you have a comment or question, we would love to hear from you as we are talking baseball right now. I want to just finish up on the Mets.
Well, I was going to say, like, kind of to echo what Joe was saying, Steve Cohen took a very disciplined and dare I say it, mature approach. Because, yes, I know a lot of Met fans want to hear, I'm firing Billy Epler, he's terrible, and I can't believe the job that Buck has done this year, he's been awful. How is that going to help? Who do you replace Buck with?
No, there's
nobody out there who you can say, you know, yeah, he'll do a better job. And if you fire Epler now, what good is that? You fire a GM midseason, your team is already put together. So there's no point to doing that. So if you're sitting there and you're making changes just to make change and to shake things up, well, then I agree with Steve Cohen in that people are gonna look at your organization and think, all right, there's a crazy man running the show. I don't want to go working in that situation.
Well, he's willing to pay, so you might change your mind, brother. You know.
I mean, yes. Did people work for George Steinbrenner? Yes,
they did.
But you know what? The Yankees had a track record of success. By that point, so
the mid-80s were horrible.
The Mets don't have that yet. The Mets won 101 games last year. Right now, they'll be lucky to win 85.
Well, what I wanted to say, the Mets are 18 games behind the Atlanta Braves. Right now, I don't even think about first place. I don't even think about the Braves. You think about the wild card position. That's the only thing. And the Mets are still behind the Marlins. They have 48 wins. The Mets have 38. Phillies have 44 wins. Mets have 38 wins,
and you're behind so many teams in the other divisions too.
Yep,
the Mets aren't even close to a wild card.
The only
reason the Mets are still listed right now in wild card contenders is because their payroll is $360 million.
Right.
Because they're not a wild card contender. It's a joke.
No, they were
what, 7-19 in June?
Yeah, they have to win most of the games in July, or it's just it's over.
Here's the reality for the Mets. I don't even. What is it? 38-46? Is that the record?
Yes.
That's 84 games.
Right.
So they have 78 games left.
Right.
The Mets have to win between 50-55 of those games just to get to the playoffs.
Yeah.
All right. So start thinking about that, Mets fans. 78 games, and you're going to need to go somewhere in the neighborhood of 50-28 or 55-23. Is this team capable of doing that? I don't think so.
Well, if they win 50 games, they're 88 wins. If they
win 88
will get you
wild card.
55, then it's 93. So
90 wins should get you a wild card.
Right.
Should. But you're talking about some very good teams out west.
This is going to be, you know what's going to happen, brother? In the end of August, they're going to start having, like, you know, free ticket games or something. You know, just show up at Citi Field and we'll give you some hot dogs or something.
Well, by then the Mets will have made a lot of trades. Because
we'll see. I don't know.
They need to unload some contracts. If nothing else, they need to unload some contracts on some contenders. And maybe they need to unload both Max Scherzer and Justin Verlander, although both of those guys have no trade clauses, but they would have to get them to waive them.
My problem with those guys, if you trade them, you're definitely picking up their contracts. You know, that's the problem. So
the team that gets them will be picking up the contracts.
No. Would you pick up the contracts of these guys, $40 million?
For 1 year, yeah.
No, I wouldn't.
For 1 year.
I wouldn't. I'd say you guys pay for it.
But the team that you would trade them to would have to be a big market team. It would
be
the
so
Dodgers.
Would be the Dodgers or the
Red Sox
Giants.
Won't get it. The Giants is a possible.
Well, maybe
Giants,
the Phillies.
It won't be the Diamondbacks, even though the Diamondbacks that's another team. It's for the Mets. The Diamondbacks, nobody expected the Diamondbacks to be in the playoff picture.
Right.
Now the Diamondbacks lead the West.
Yep.
And you have to look at them as a playoff team.
Anyway, brother, we have Hank from Seaford returning to call in. Hello, Hank. Welcome back to From the Press Box. How you doing? What do you want to talk about?
Hey, guys. How you doing?
Hey, Hank.
Hey, good morning. You know, it was funny. It's probably maybe late May or early June. The Mets were still 5.5 games behind the Braves, and I'm like, you know what, there's a little hope in this, but they totally blew it in June.
Well, don't forget, the Braves played out of their minds in June also.
Yeah, they played fantastic.
The Mets lost something. I don't even know how many games it is, but we'd have to take a look. But the Mets lost something like 16 games to the Braves just in June. It's insane. The Braves won 20-something games in June. And when I say 20-something, I don't mean 21. It was like 24 or 25. That's a hell of a month.
Yeah. If I could change subjects a little bit here, I'm going to pick your baseball minds here. Two comments. What do you think about Pete Rose, and what do you think about the steroid guys? Do you think they're ever going to get a shot at the Hall of Fame?
Pete Rose, definitely not, because that ship has sailed. There are people who I think if Pete Rose gets in, it'll be posthumously. I don't think baseball wants Pete Rose to make any more money off of gambling on the game. And I think that a lot of baseball purists go back to the whole Bart Giamatti decision and Faye Vincent kind of confirmed this, that their opinion of what Rose did, I think, was a lot more serious than what the general public sees it as. And especially nowadays, where Major League Baseball has sponsorship deals with gambling websites, and you know, so much of our sports just in the last few years has started to revolve around gambling, and our society has become more involved in gambling. And I know that I have friends in the UK where this has been normal for them for decades. But our society has become more accepting of it, but I still don't think that would help Pete Rose's case in any way, just because when he bet on baseball, first of all, he bet against his team some days, and secondly, he knew what the potential consequences were, and he did it anyway. I mean, I don't know if you saw it, but the NFL just suspended three or four players for the entire season just for placing bets in their team's facility.
If they would have made
the bets at home, they wouldn't have gotten suspended, which to me is a hypocritical, you know, it's ridiculously hypocritical. But the NFL is saying, look, this is an ironclad rule. You are not allowed to make bets while you were in an NFL facility or on NFL property.
Yeah. So well, I agree with what you're saying. I also think that Pete Rose was not he wasn't the best example, and he didn't help his cause, because he was kind of a jerk the last 30 years.
Yeah, and he did nothing but lie over and over again until he finally confessed. But when he confessed, he was selling a book.
Yeah.
So the reason he confessed was to make money.
Personally, I think when Pete Rose passes, they'll put him in somewhere. Somehow, I think
it'll still take a few years.
Yeah, I think so, too. But I think they're waiting personally. So, as Timmy said, he can't make a buck on it. You know, I personally wish I'd read the report that came out about that. I've never read the report, so I don't know what's in it. We all know now it's, you know, gambling has changed the sports world so much, because you know what bothers me about the gambling? It's not that people can gamble, or you might have a game that looks suspicious because, you know, a weird call at the end or something. My problem with the gambling is it's taken over so much of sports, meaning, like, you know, on ESPN or on WFAN or whatever, they talk about gambling like it matters to the game. The game itself doesn't get affected by gambling unless you gamble on it. And that's
right.
The part.
I noticed that. Yeah, I noticed that.
So if I go
to the game, get a hot dog, and then keep gambling on your team, and it's like expected to that.
Right, and that's
right.
The part.
I don't gamble, so.
Yeah, I don't either. But I don't think you should gamble. You shouldn't be allowed to gamble once the game starts. You know, they have it like, well, it's the fourth inning now. Maybe you want to place another bet. Maybe so-and-so is going to get a home run, and you can bet on it.
That's the game now. I mean,
that's not sports. It's gambling.
I know, but when I was watching the Yankees game yesterday, they start the game with, all right, this is the over-under for runs in the game.
Right.
What do you want to do? And then in the third or the fourth inning, it's like, all right, here's the adjusted line, and now you can make bets on this. And it's like, you know, like, Why do we keep hyping this up? Why are we trying? You know, why are we pushing gambling so hard on the viewers? Let them just watch the game.
I agree. Yeah. I agree.
By the way, I just looked it up. Pete Rose is now 82 years old.
Wow.
All right. Pete, I hate to say it because, you know, I still think Pete is one of the all-time greats. He's not going to be with us a whole lot longer. 82 is pretty old.
There was a great thing I saw when he was on Fox Sports, and he was showing how to hit. And it was so he knew so much.
Oh, he's an encyclopedia.
And even like he showed A-Rod and who's the other guy?
Big Poppy?
No.
Thomas?
No, it was Harold Reynolds. I think it was.
I don't know. Maybe.
And
Harold Reynolds needed hitting lessons when he was a player.
Well, maybe it wasn't Harold Reynolds, but I know it was A-Rod. And even A-Rod's learning, even though he's not playing anymore. He's saying.
And A-Rod knows a ton.
Yeah. So you know, the sadness about Pete Rose is. His knowledge about baseball is so great, but he felt that he had to gamble. You know, if he'd bet on football instead of baseball, he'd be in the Hall of Fame right now.
And he still bets on the horses pretty much every day.
Yeah, he's a horse guy, too. So
He's a degenerate gambler, plain and simple.
He is.
There's no way around that. He is.
He'd probably
he'll never admit it, but he is.
School soccer game that he knows nothing about.
Absolutely.
So
the only thing I feel is like... His stats were just so amazing, and you know what? Occasionally he will pull a little heartstring, and you think maybe the old man will get in. But again, I think his bad attitude through the years. I'm still mad he ruined Ray Foskey's career in the All Star. I'm mad he beat up Harrelson. You know,
no, Harrelson beat him up. Let's be honest.
A little before my time on that one.
We call it a draw, but he's got his faults. But I mean, he was Mr. Charlie Hustle, and I hope he gets in. Maybe after he dies, you know, that kind of thing. But what do you think about these steroid guys? You know, talking about A-Rod and Roger Clemens and Barry Bonds.
I think the attitude is softening a little bit with those guys, but I'm not sure that they'll get in, only because. It was supposed to be, the attitude to me anyway, was that the writers weren't going to vote them in, and if the Veterans Committee wanted to, well, let's leave it up to them. And that kind of seems to me how it is, although guys like Clemens, they didn't really see a big jump. Clemens and Bonds this year didn't see a big jump, but I look at it as... I think their numbers went up somewhat, but I just see the writers kind of kicking the can down the road and putting it on the Veterans Committee and them saying that, you know, hey, if they want to put them in, let them do it. Let's face it. The players probably know better as far as who was taking steroids and who wasn't. Some of these guys have admitted it, and the ones who have admitted, like, I don't think A-Rod's ever getting in. The guy's got 690-something home runs. I don't think he's ever getting in because he admitted he did it.
And plus, he got suspended a full season.
Well, yeah, but, I mean, at that point, his career was pretty much over anyway. I mean, he came back, he had the one good season, and he was done.
Have you, as a sports writer, had the opportunity to vote on these?
I have not. My friend Dave Buscema, he had a vote. He had a vote for several years, and I'll say that he consulted me on a couple of occasions, and there were a couple of occasions where I was fairly adamant that he should vote for somebody. But one time he listened to me, and one time he did not, so it didn't always work out that way. Having the Hall of Fame vote. First of all, I don't like what they've done with it because after you've stopped covering baseball for a certain number of years, they take the vote away from you. And I personally think it's stupid because if somebody covered baseball for 30 years and is voting on Hall of Fame players and you take their vote away five years after they stop covering baseball, well, what about all that knowledge? I mean, they have all that knowledge. They've seen all of these players. And now you're just going to take a vote away from them because they retired?
Well,
idiotic.
I want to bring up a name, and we've had him on the show several times.
Who's that?
Hal Bach, who was the United Press International guy to cover the World Series. Him and the AP guy shared the first two spots in the press box. His knowledge of baseball is still better than most people we know. And whenever he comes on, he's right up to date with everything. So
and Phil Pepe,
when he was alive, he was right on top of things, even though he hadn't covered baseball in a long time. So,
because he watched every game.
Right. So to take away that right, if they're still involved watching and being, you know, some sort of, you know, they're watching it still. They're still involved in the game that way. I think you do it. I mean, you know, as Timmy said, these guys have a certain knowledge that no one else has.
I am somebody who respects experience, and not everybody does, and it seems like the more we go on as society, that experience is being respected less and less, and I'm completely opposite. If somebody's been doing something and doing it well for, you know, a couple of decades or whatever it is, I don't know why all of a sudden that you ignore all of that experience and give those responsibilities to somebody who's been covering baseball for like 5 years.
Yeah,
what does that person know?
For example, we've had Bill Madden on the show, and Bill isn't a full-time writer anymore, but he still writes for the Daily News, and same with Mike Lupica. They're basically Sunday guys, and, you know, they're part of the Sunday paper. Do you not include them because they're not day-to-day at the ballpark?
They've been writing for 40, 50 years.
Yeah, right, so exactly. You know, you got to look at it that way.
They've seen a lot, and you could say they've seen it all, but they've seen a lot. And you, like I said, you don't replace that with somebody who's been on the beat for 3 or 4 years.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's true. Can I ask one more question?
Sure, go ahead.
Okay. Actually, I follow Vada Pinson, his son.
Okay.
And his son is trying to get his dad into the Hall of Fame. Like, hey, please support my dad. And, like, you know, I remember him, you know, growing up. And, I mean, he's actually got some pretty good stats. And I don't think he was involved in anything controversial. I mean, I might be wrong, but if you want to look him up, whatever your thoughts. I think he had something like 2,700, 2,800 hits. He definitely had home runs and RBIs, a good average, you know?
Okay, these are his numbers. 2,757 for the hits, 256 okay. homers, batting average 286.
What? How many years? He played probably like 18.
He started
seasons.
Really 58 was a half a season to 75. So
that's
he
17 so yeah, 16 seasons.
16 seasons basically. He led the league in a couple of times on different things with hits, 208 and 61, 63 at 204 hits. He had a, you know, you know what? Let's see.
Vada Pinson for me, he's one of those guys that, especially back in the day, he would have been one of those guys where people used him as kind of the cutoff. Like, the Hall of Fame is for great players, not very good players. Vada Pinson was a very good player. And He was a very good hitter. I mean, obviously this is a lot of his career came before my time, but in the research that I've done about him, and, you know, like I've always been kind of curious about you know, very good players, and when you hear somebody's name enough, you get curious enough to say, all right, well, what did this guy do? And for me, Vada Pinson, close, absolutely, but Hall of Famer, I don't know, because to me, if the Veterans Committee wanted to put him in, because I look at Harold Baines, and to me, Harold Baines is not a Hall of Famer. I don't care what the Veterans Committee did. He's not a Hall of Famer.
You know what?
Very good player, had some great seasons.
You'd want him on your team. Let's put it that way.
But want him on your team is not a Hall of Famer.
Well,
Hall of Famer is supposed to be for the elite. Harold Baines doesn't fit that bill.
Vada Pinson also played in Cincinnati and California and Kansas City. So he didn't, you know, appear in New York all the time. Let's put it this way.
I mean, that doesn't really
count. 4 years, he had 4 years where he batted over 300. And he had three more seasons where he batted over 280.
What about comparing him to Tony Perez? Isn't Tony Perez in the Hall of Fame?
I don't know.
Fairly certain that the Veterans Committee put him in.
I think so.
But Pinson was an outfielder, no?
Yeah.
Yeah, and Perez was a first baseman. That you're talking about kind of, I don't want to say dangerous, like, you know, like.
He is in the Hall of Fame.
It's kind of a dangerous comparison because it's different positions. It's to me, it's hard. It's hard to, and you know, outfielders, I think you can get away with a guy being more like of a speed guy. You know, and a hitter as opposed to, like, you know, you can get away with an outfielder not having the kind of power numbers that a first baseman pretty much would have to get into the Hall of Fame.
Perez's numbers are batting average of 279, home runs 379, not bad.
Yeah.
RBI 1652, but he also was on the Big Red Machine.
He was in the middle of that lineup.
Yeah, so that helps a lot when you're putting this type of thing together. So I don't know, man. I think Perez should be in there. I think Vada Pinson should be in there too. Timmy disagrees.
I would say a difficult no on Vada Pinson. Close, very close. But
at least his son's trying, because no one else is going to try for him. And
I see him on Facebook, and I'm interested in that stuff. And I just looked up the stats, and I'm like, you know, they look pretty good. You know,
they are pretty good. I agree with you. And you know, sometimes it might take a little longer than you would think, but maybe he gets in down the road. I would put him in down the road, but that's just me. We appreciate you calling, Hank. Thank you very much.
Nice chatting. Have a great day.
Call in next week.
Thanks,
we appreciate
you too, Hank.
90.3 WHPC from the press box right here on nccradio.org, iheartradio.com, tunein.com, odyssey.com, and the WHPC app. We're going to take a break right now, brother. We'll be back right after this.
This show on 90.3 WHPC is brought to you by Tropical Smoothie Cafe of West Hempstead, located at 474 Hempstead Turnpike. Tropical Smoothie Cafe of West Hempstead offers fresh, made-to-order smoothies, wraps, sandwiches, and flatbreads. More information about how you can get yourself on Tropic Time at Tropical Smoothie Cafe in West Hempstead can be found at 516-427-5109, online at tropicalsmoothiecafe.com, or on TikTok at Tropical Smoothie Cafe. FANY42.
Okay.
Yo.
Tell your friends about the Nassau Morning Madhouse. Hear what you're missing.
Check it out.
You got any luck stories for me?
My sophomore year of high school, during the lacrosse season, mm-hmm. I would get the pass from the guy, I would shoot the ball and score. That worked first try.
Let's go.
Yeah.
And my first and only goal in high school.
So Frank,
but that
me,
was
Frank.
That doesn't
Let's
sound
go.
Like luck. That doesn't
yes,
sound
it
like luck. How is that luck? That's hard work, dedication. Luck is for losers. That's why I wrote
tears.
Nothing down and just drew a spider on my car.
Wow.
There's no such thing as luck. First try, and that was random. You were dedicating your life to being the best lacrosse player ever.
And we were
you
not
made your own luck. Get your ass out there and start winning! Get the luck out of here!
Oh my goodness.
Shut the luck up! We don't need any luck!
Nassau Morning Madhouse. Weekday mornings from 7 to 9.
Yeah.
On the voice of Nassau Community College.
90.3 WHPC.
It's Big Ed inviting you to join me Mondays from 10 till noon for the Good Gold Show. We've got the greatest hits of all time, all your faves of the 50s, 60s, and 70s, a whole lot of fun, and we'll keep you informed. Plus, we'll take your requests and your dedications.
Playing favorites.
So join me Mondays from 10 till noon for Good Gold on 90.3 WHPC, available on the Odyssey, iHeart, and WHPC apps.
Wow.
WHPC, the voice of Nassau Community College. This is from the press box. My name is Rob Leonard. He is Tim Leonard, award-winning sports writer. And your WHPC weather forecast, powered by Pantanos, with locations in Hewlett, Uniondale, Garden City Park, Freeport, and now open in Levittown. This afternoon's going to be mostly cloudy, but it's going to be high about 86. This is starting to get warm. This is actually summer weather. Tonight will be scattered thunderstorms, low about 74, currently outside the studios at Nassau Community College. It is currently 83 degrees. What do you have?
I got 76 on my phone, brother.
Really? The thing says here, 83. I'll go with that. What it says here, brother. Anyway, one more thing about the Mets before we go over to the Yankees. Bobby Bonilla Day was celebrated on July 1st. I know you raised the glass for Bobby, and
it's also Rick DiPietro Day, by the way. He's got a similar deal with the Islanders.
That's true.
For about another 8 years.
That's true. They overpaid him too, but then again, Pietro was. I forgot why
he got hurt.
You know, but why they redid his contract? I mean, Bonilla is because the Wilpons had problems with Bernie Madoff. I think that was one of the problems with that. I wonder.
It was actually a way to save money, believe it or not. Because despite all the money they're paying him, it was a way to save money at the time.
Right. And, you know, instead of paying, you know, $50 million or whatever the number was, they said, we'll pay $1 million for the rest of your life. It continues, actually, until 2035. And you know what? If I was Uncle Stevie, I would have said to the Wilpons, guess what? This is coming out of your money.
I would, too.
You know?
And that's you're writing that check, not me.
But I don't know if that happened. You know,
Who knows? Who knows? I mean, that Steve Cohen, being the Mets fan that he is, you know he asked about it.
I would. That is, you know, to me, it is like, you know, kicking the can down the road. And, you know, Fred and Jeffy did not care because they just wanted to, you know, not pay at that moment.
Because they're not very good, that's why.
Well, they weren't the smartest businessmen. Hey, the Mets won a couple of times. We can't say anything bad about that. Anyway, brother, let's quickly talk about the Yankees. There was a perfect game, Domingo Germán.
Pretty impressive.
Against the Oakland Athletics. People say, oh, it's against the Oakland Athletics. It's still a perfect game.
Athletics hadn't had a perfect game thrown against them in more than 100 years. So,
really? Wow.
Yeah. So I don't care if it was only the Oakland Athletics. You still have to get 27 up, 27 down.
That's right.
It is one of, if not the hardest accomplishment in sports.
Right.
Because you have to be perfect. Somebody gets on base, you're not perfect anymore. So congratulations to Domingo Germán. He was outstanding. 99 pitches in his perfect game. In the last inning, the ninth inning, where you expect all the nerves and all the, you know, like, you really, you know, you hope he can hold it together long right. enough to make 6 pitches in that inning.
That's what you want.
Just phenomenal. So congratulations to him. Clearly the highlight of the Yankees week, because there wasn't a whole lot else that was good in the Yankees week. They played against the Oakland Athletics and the St. Louis Cardinals, two last place teams, albeit both on the road, but they went 3-3. You got to go 5-1 against those teams. You got to sweep. First of all, the Athletics, they lost the first game, 2-1. And that game, for me, totally encapsulates the Yankees without Aaron Judge. They can't hit. And it's like we were saying to Joe earlier, the lineup is a joke.
Yeah.
There's nothing there. There's nothing of major league quality that I can confidently say, yes, this is a playoff team. Because it's not. There's too many guys in this on the roster and in the lineup who are career, either minor leaguers, fourth outfielders. Anthony Rizzo isn't doing a whole lot without Judge there. Gleyber Torres is playing okay at best. The catching situation, that's, you know, Trevino was good in the first half last year. He's kind of reverted back to his mean. But the outfield is a bad joke. Bader is healthy, so he's a decent bat. But how are you winning games when Bader can't stay healthy and he's one of your better bats? Gleyber has just been average, and Anthony Volpe for the last 2 weeks or 2.5 weeks has probably been your best hitter.
And
DJ LeMay, who's making $15 million a year, he's batting .220.
You gotta like Volpe. I like him.
I love him. And what did I say all season? I said before the season, this kid, his history is. First half, struggle. Second half, he gets it, and he turns it on. Well, we're here. And Volpe, for the last 16 or 17 games, is batting about .350.
Well, brother, get this. Get this about the craziness of the AL East. Still, all 5 teams are over .500. Get this about the AL Central. All 5 teams are under 500.
Yeah, exactly.
That is incredibly horrible.
Yeah.
You think about it.
Welcome to Major League Baseball.
Oh, my God.
And as Cousin Corey said last weekend, they want to make a division for Major League Baseball that has the Yankees, Mets, Phillies, and Red Sox in it.
Yeah. Yeah.
You don't think every one of those teams is going to be above .550? Come on.
And the Yankees are in the wild card. They're the last team in the wild card race. I know it's real early to say that, but
I don't know if they're going to hang on to that spot. I really don't.
Well,
because they can't hit.
Well, they're only 3 games behind the Orioles, so.
And the Orioles have struggled lately. The good news for the Yankees, brother, Carlos Rodon, your boy,
is
finally going to get his first Yankee start.
Wow.
On Friday against the Cubs, he had his third and final rehab start, I believe it was yesterday, and pitched well. So Friday it is. He's finally a six-year, $162 million contract, and he's finally going to make his Yankees debut on July, whatever Friday is, the 6th or something. Who knows why it took so long? It's crazy. But this is the guy's history. He gets hurt, and hopefully this will be his only injury of the year. You figure he missed 3 months. It should be the only injury. But the Yankees need this guy to be, I don't want to say like, you know, Gerrit Cole-like, but they need him to be kind of an ace. Because, yes, Herman pitched a perfect game, and he has pitched fairly well this season. But the two starts before that, Herman became the first pitcher to pitch a perfect game the next start after giving up, I think it was 10 runs in a start. I mean, it's ridiculous. His two previous starts before the perfect game were abysmal. And the Yankees are still trying to figure it out. Severino has been getting knocked around. Clark Schmidt has been hit or miss. And Nestor Cortez is hurt. So the Yankees could use some starting pitching because, like I said, basically their offense isn't capable of scoring more than 3 runs. And, yes, I know they scored a bunch of runs in the second and third games against Oakland. But look at what they did against the Cardinals. It wasn't impressive.
No, not at all. But, hey, let's talk about it quickly. The All-Star game's coming up. Aaron Judge is voted in as a starter. Obviously, he's not playing. Gerrit Cole is the only other Yankee on the team. Pete Alonso is the only Met voted in. Just goes to show you that anyone can get voted in.
Pete was selected as a reserve, brother.
He was not
voted in. The Braves. This is the National League East in a nutshell. The Atlanta Braves have 8 players on the National League All-Star team, and the Mets have 1.
Yeah, well,
there's your season right there.
It's a popularity contest.
It's not a popularity contest. The Braves had 2 guys voted in.
Okay, and then the Home Run Derby is next Monday. The game is on Tuesday. One thing that gets me of what they're doing a like a fashion walk thing, like a, you know, red carpet thing for Major League Baseball.
They want to make it more. Did you see Scott Boras last night on the K-Rod cast?
I try not to see him anymore.
Well, he makes the point. He you know what? People hate him, and I know he is a very abrasive person.
Yes, he is.
But he makes a lot of good points. And I didn't necessarily like this point that he made about turning the World Series into a neutral site proposition, but it wouldn't be the worst thing in the world because the Super Bowl is a neutral site proposition, and he wants to make the World Series a big event like the Super Bowl.
Yeah, but what are you going to do? You're going to only have it in New York?
No,
which would be great.
They would probably put it in somewhere in Florida or Texas or someplace or San Diego where it doesn't rain a whole lot and the weather is nice.
Yeah, but
you got either that or you put it in a dome, one or the other.
That's
like the NFL does.
You have it in Kansas City? No. No, you know, you don't want that. I like
Kansas City doesn't have a dome, brother.
I'm just saying. You know, I don't want it. I like the way it works right now. If it was one game, yeah, I can understand that. 7 games, the home field advantage is very important. So, but they are doing that stupid, red carpet thing. Like I give a damn about what people
want.
They
want to make it an event. That's how you make it an event. How you do it today, in today's world.
You know who covers it? People Magazine. They don't even know who the players are.
Well, that's what it is. So I don't know what else to tell you.
I don't know either. Anyway, so that's happening. As a matter of fact, I don't even care about the Home Run Derby anymore. Pete Alonso's in, brother. I like that, but I don't really care anymore, you know.
He was stoked. That was his word, stoked.
Yeah. So anyway, quickly, Josh Bailey of the Islanders, he was traded with a second round pick in 2026 to the Chicago Blackhawks for future considerations, and then the Blackhawks dumped Josh Bailey. So this was
unloaded. That's $5 million.
Yes, there was a salary cap thing. Josh Bailey is now a free agent, technically. Though I don't think you don't think he'll sign with the Islanders again, but
I think technically
he could re-sign with the Islanders for minimum.
I think Josh Bailey's career is all but over. I think if he does play in the NHL next year, it will be for a not very good team at somewhere around the NHL minimum or slightly above it.
Yeah, with the Islanders.
He's 33, 34 years old.
Yeah.
He last year he had 8 goals and 17 assists in 64 games, I think it was.
Yeah.
That's not a guy that teams are desperate to sign.
No, but
you know, maybe a young team that needs a veteran presence, maybe, but that's a guy you can replace with somebody in your farm system and replace him with an AHL guy who's 22 years old and is looking for a roster spot. And that guy, you don't have to pay anything. You pay him the minimum. You pay him the rookie minimum, and see what he has. And that guy will bust his butt for you every game. I'm not saying that Josh Bailey won't, but Josh Bailey has been there. He's played 1,057 games for the Islanders. He's had a career.
Yeah, no, I can still see the Islanders, you know, maybe before the season starts, you know, we need a guy like him.
No, they don't.
Saying it could.
They don't. It's not
you could,
going
out. You could.
I'm telling you, it's not happening.
You could, though.
In a court of law, brother, sure, you could.
Yes, there you go.
Not happening. Trust my opinion, brother.
I don't trust your opinion.
The big news for the Islanders in the last few days was an 8-year, $66 million extension for goaltender Ilya Sorokin. Islanders had to get that done. That's an average annual value of $8.25 million for Sorokin, who was second in the Vezina Trophy voting this season. And really, as far as I'm concerned, was the main reason why the Islanders even qualified for the playoffs this year.
I agree. I mean, without him, the Islanders are even worse than they are.
Way worse.
Really bad. Just quickly, brother, what do you want to talk about? We have like a page and a half of notes here.
Well, NBA free agency started the other day. Very quickly, the Knicks have signed former Villanova star Dante DiVincenzo to a 4-year, $50 million deal, which is actually a pretty decent price for him. And Josh Hart opted in for another year at $12.9 million. So the Knicks now have three former Villanova champions on their roster. And the Knicks are trading former lottery pick Obi Toppin to the Pacers for a pair of second-round picks. This one's going to bite the Knicks, I'm telling you, brother. Obi Toppin, if he starts for the Pacers this year, I am telling you right now, he is going to average 18-7 for the Pacers. And the Knicks are going to look like morons for getting a couple of second-round picks. There should have been a clause in that trade or something that performance-based where the Knicks could have turned those two second-rounders into a first-rounder. Toppin's going to make the Knicks look like idiots on this, I'm telling you.
Yeah, he was a guy waiting for a team to give him a chance. Yeah.
And that team wasn't the Knicks.
No, unfortunately. Just quickly, brother, I have to read this. WHPC welcomes 90s bands, the Gin Blossoms, Tonic, and Fastball to the Paramount in Huntington on Tuesday, September 12th. Tickets are available now. But you can try to win tickets right now on the WHPC app. Download the app and click the Win Tickets button now to enter the win. Good luck from the voice of Nassau Community College and the WHPC app.
Do it. Do it now.
Do it now. So, I don't know. You know, quickly, in soccer, brother, what's going on with the...
Jesus Ferreira, brother.
United States.
Became the first American men's team player to score hat tricks in consecutive games. He got three goals on Sunday against Trinidad and Tobago in group play in the Gold Cup. Ferrara had scored a hat-trick a few nights earlier in a game against St. Kitts and Nevis. I don't even know where that is or what that is, but yes, it's really a country.
Right.
But first American men's player ever to score hat-tricks in consecutive games, so congratulations to him. U.S. advanced to the quarterfinals of the Gold Cup, and we'll find out who they play tomorrow when the results of Group D are finished.
That's good news.
Yes.
Anyway, coming up next, brother, our friend Big Ed. We'll be doing the Good Gold Show, as he always does every Monday at 10 o'clock. So we want to say thank you for everyone calling in, Hank and Joe, for calling in. We'll be back next week. This show becomes a podcast later on. Thank you for listening. Take care, and bye-bye.
The views expressed on air are not necessarily those of WHPC, its management, or Nassau Community College. Responsible opposing viewpoints will be considered by emailing them to whpc@ncc.edu or by mail at WHPC One Education Drive, Garden City, New York, 11530. Thanks for listening to the voice of Nassau Community College, 90.3 WHPC.